Yes, sir, we promised you a great main event here tonight.
Nick Andre,
the China.
WrestleMania!
WrestleMania is running west!
My God, what a
told y'all come back, right? All right, everybody, welcome back to the Rick Talk Podcast. This is your host, Ricky motherfucking Rhymes. And I tried coming back last week, man. What? YouTube just did not want me back. They just thought like, oh, this guy's going to go ahead and fuck up the algorithm by trying to do some, what is that thing called? Copyright infringement. Yes. So what happened was I tried putting out my video finally, and it was a podcast, and the podcast is actually up, but just not my visual podcast. The vision, everything that I wanted to do, it's, you know, it's great. It's honestly spectacular. Why? Because if I don't have any fuck-ups, then I'm going to be complacent, going to be comfortable eventually, and I hate that. But we're not here to get comfortable, not yet at least. And I'm here just to have fun. I'm here to be back in front of a camera, back to talk to people, and fight my fears. Like, literally, one of the biggest fears I had was getting back in the camera and seeing myself like this and being extremely, super judgmental of myself. But the problem is that you can't jump into the public eye without any scrutiny. And that's things that I learned over time. Like, you know, it's completely normal to get scrutinized. I mean, hey, like right now I have the porno stash, or this is a bad idea to say that, but I have the really big bold stash right now, and the eyebrows are just extremely bold because I accidentally went too low on my beard. But hey, it's whatever, hair grows back except for the top, but we'll get into the top later on. We're here for one big thing and one main thing, and that's honestly me to unbox some toys. Big thing about me right now is that I have really great pay right now. Very happy with the pay. And one of the best things about me is that, well, for one, I love wrestling. I love talking about wrestling. That's why you're here, the viewer. And I'm here to unbox a new wrestler of mine, one that I'm not too familiar with, but familiar enough to know the name, familiar to know that he's fought some really great wrestlers, some very favorites of mine, very big favorites of mine. And he's considered the best in the world. And by the time I show you the packaging, you're probably going to be flipping in your heads right now. Like, are you serious? You're going to throw your phone at me and wish that I wasn't on this earth, because I have no idea how he fights. I don't know anything about the lore of this character, nothing about him, but I got to learn a lot more throughout the weekend about him. So, coming fresh off of camping, I was so happy to know that this wrestler was finally going to come to my doorstep. It took all day, and my girlfriend was like kind of getting irritated by the fact that, like, dude, like, you looked at the over, like, you opened the door like four times today. And I'm like, look, the mail said literally 6:45 a.m. to 10:45 a.m. In between those time slots, I'm expecting the package to finally come up to the doorstep already. And I was so excited when I saw a package there, and it turned out it wasn't him yet. And I was upset because I was just like, when is this fucking package going to arrive? And turns out it didn't, and then the time got escalated to 12:45 p.m. So I'm like, okay, I'm gonna wait a couple more hours. I'll knock out some grass. I'll just go ahead and take care of what I have to in the meantime. 12:45 passes, and now it escalated all the way to 8 p.m. And I'm just like, bullshit. I really wanted to see this fucking toy already. I wanted it in my hands already. And pause. And I just wanted to go ahead and see what this toy was all about. And today we have Kenny Omega! Kenny Omega! As Justin Roberts would announce him. But, yeah. This is a Kenny Omega. This is Series 1, Version 2, Unrivaled Collection. This is the Kenny Omega that fought May 25th, 2019, Double or Nothing in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm super excited about this one. This is the one that actually fought Chris Jericho. And I believe this is the same pay-per-view that Kenny Omega got attacked by Jon Moxley, who was formerly known as Dean Ambrose.
And I demand a thank you.
To say thanks. John Moxley has deployed on the squared circle at the MGM Grand Garden Arena with a twinkle in his eye, and Jericho is pissed. Moxley carving a path of destruction in the abyss. Omega, Moxley, on top of the stack of death, DDT. Oh, what a moment. How do you like AEW now?
He's not done with him.
Oh! They wrecked that broken nose of Omega. Oh my God. What the hell? Omega fighting out of it. Desperation. Oh! Good God! Oh my God! Get the EMTs out here! Moxley has destroyed Kenny Omega! My God, what a night! What a night! It was here!
Now, that's the only way I saw Kenny Omega. I knew about Kenny Omega from Wrestle Kingdom prior years, and that he was a New Japan boy. I had no idea about this guy. And then one day I'm just stumbling upon some Talk as Jericho's, and I'm just listening about Kenny Omega, and I'm like, saw this guy at 25 years old, said no to WWE. He's just like, I went through the boot camp and everything like that, and he just decided that he's not going to go about, you know, the WWE way. And he just said that he's just going to just find himself. He's going to go ahead and definitely just work on the character that he wants to be. He's going to write his own tale. To skip WWE, he told John Laurinaitis, like, I want to go to Japan. Can you help me get there? And John Laurinaitis was super nice enough, even though he's really hated, especially by CM Punk. You know, he was nice enough to go ahead and help Kenny Omega do his thing. And as of today, this guy is considered the best in the world right now. Like, you know, one of the best ones alive. And he faced off against Chris Jericho back in, I believe it was 2017. In 2016, I think they had a talk. Or 2017, they had a talk. And then they eventually fought each other. And wow, like, super excited to open this. This is going to be a little intense because I love opening action figures. But, you know, the one thing I don't like about the packaging of the AEW wrestlers. Now, don't get me wrong. This is some... Uh-oh. This is some awesome packaging, right? This is... I like that the fact that they have everything the way it is. I even like the back because it shows you just when they fought in this attire. And one big thing about me. Okay, so to explain my love about the wrestlers... for example, if I go ahead and grab this Eddie Guerrero, for example. Now, wasn't the best with my Jack-specific wrestlers. So this is an Eddie Guerrero, right? Now, this Eddie is really, like, special to me. Now, for one thing, if you guys know about this Eddie Guerrero action figure, this is the Eddie Guerrero that would grab Rey Mysterio's mask after he ripped it and destroyed Rey. He would come out and he would wear, like, this yellow shirt with the tux and everything like that and, you know, give us some really great in-ring promos. And the thing about this Eddie Guerrero is that this attire jacket isn't really his jacket. I lost or I screwed up the last jacket that he was supposed to originally wear, and this is actually Edge's jacket that belonged to the Edge that I had that came with a hardcore title and as well as a Mick Foley companion that I had when I was a kid. And the thing about the attires is that they're so special, especially like colorful ones, like ones that pop out or, you know, when they come on TV, like, you know, you want that action figure. Like, I've seen attires throughout my childhood that were just super cool. And then when they were in the stores, like, I was so happy to, you know, to get them, you know. I was a spoiled little brat, don't get me wrong. But, you know, ever since I started working, I never asked my parents for a dime. I didn't make them buy me anything or, you know, they asked, you know. Obviously, you're going to say, like, oh, I actually want this. But I'm older now, and the fact that I love wrestling, and I'm very open about my passion of loving wrestling so much that I completely love the fact that, you know, I can go to a store and find these and buy them. And this goes all the way back to when I used to work at this shitty job. First starting off living in Rockford, I had to drive all the way to Elgin every morning that I worked. Sometimes even Palatine, just to go to Elgin after that and just to go back to Rockford. Like, it was one of the worst jobs I ever worked in. But every part of my experience is a great learning experience. And one of the things that I noticed when I was working at these Targets every day was when I would work right by the toy aisle and where they would sell phones, I would see like new toys pop up every day. And I saw people my age, like, literally looking for toys, and I'm over here trying to sell them a phone, and, you know, they're just telling me, like, oh, no, I'm good. And I'm like, oh, toy collector? Yeah. Which one are you looking for today? And then they would just tell me G.I. Joe, or none of them particularly, like, wrestling, but, like, I just felt like, damn, I really want these toys, and especially the wrestlers that started coming out, like, The Fiend was definitely somebody that made me want to buy an action figure again, like, just based off the face and the stuff that they would come with, the title belts, or just, like, the extra heads, like, the extra head scans that you can, like, change, because, like, when I was a kid, there was no way of changing the head of a wrestler, and as many times as I popped off heads or broke, you know, arms or feet, you know, like I said, I wasn't the best with wrestlers, because obviously, I mean, I gave so many fucking wrestlers super kicks with Shawn Michaels, as you can tell. Shawn lost a foot, everybody lost a head. And I shit you not, like, even though, like, I wasn't the best to play with wrestlers, even because compared to now, I really am very careful. But I kind of fucked up the other day when I accidentally skid somebody's head on the mat. Yeah, I fucked up there. But it was just crazy when I actually did work with those, and to see them now, and to see, like, as much as effort as Mattel puts into, like, these toys now, especially the way Jack Specific treats the AEW wrestlers, like, it's so fucking great. It's so cool, and I get very excited to see, like, what these wrestlers come with, what kind of attires they wear, and I've skipped a bunch of wrestlers, don't get me wrong. Like, I'm not just buying every wrestler that I see. If that was the case, I'd be spending, like, almost $200 every week. But I'm not doing that, and I'm very cautious about what I'm going to buy, because the wrestler has to have purpose. It has to have meaning to me. And this one particularly, like, okay. So, my experience, I've been going on Ringside Collectibles, like, sometimes I go every day. Don't get me wrong. I go every day just to see what they have new, what comes out in pre-orders, what's the top-selling wrestler at the moment. And I was part of the clan that made Cody Rhodes, like, the, you know, the TNT championship one. I was part of that clan that made it number one, because once Cody Rhodes returned, I'm like, I have to get a Cody Rhodes action figure. But the thing with Kenny Omega, me listening to, like, the podcast with Chris Jericho and kind of learning more about Kenny Omega's, like, past and, like, what's to come in the future, the guy is almost 40 years old, and he's one of the best wrestlers in the world, you know, part of the Bullet Club in the past, and, you know, part of AEW now and just kind of just being like, you know, one of the top wrestlers in the world. Like, it intrigues me. It intrigues me to kind of learn more about the Bullet Club. Because for one, I do have a Finn Balor action figure, and I love this Finn Balor because this is heel. This is heel Finn Balor. The Finn Balor that I grown accustomed to loving, because I as much as I loved Finn Balor, I loved the idea of Finn Balor, but I didn't love the fact that he was just overly face, and it's just kind of like felt like, okay, you're shoving this guy and down our throats because you guys just don't know how to book him right. And I'm pretty sure if he was in another company, like an independent company, he would find a better way to be utilized. And WWE is the best company as far as being the big one, the main one, the one that all the kids watch. And some people just take, you know, it's more of a family event more than it is like the pro wrestling company to watch, which is like AEW, because, you know, it's pro wrestling at its, you know, at its most, it's like the top indie level company, as opposed to like New Japan, which is like, you know, one of the most sacred companies in the world. So with all that being said, and enough of me like talking so much, I'm just really intrigued by this, because the podcasts that are going to follow is me learning a lot more about the Bullet Club, and eventually me just collecting everyone that's part of the Bullet Club, and me putting together a giant Bullet Club. And after that, you know, we'll see what happens. But I'm fairly new to collecting wrestlers. I believe Kenny Omega is my 15th wrestler that I bought this year. Yeah, that says a lot that happened in the last, like, 3 months. But I was just been talking so much that now it's time to finally open Kenny Omega and see what we have here. For one thing, like, the packaging was actually damaged to begin with, and that made him $20. One day I saw that a Kenny Omega was finally available on Ringside Collectibles, and $30 was kind of cutting it for me too, because, like, I mean, I'm cheap in a sense of, like, you know, I won't buy him yet. Maybe, like, if I save up a little bit more, you know. And I was even thinking about just, like, getting the Kenny Omega that came with a AEW wrestling ring, which I still might buy an AEW wrestling ring, but I'm still in the midst of, you know, saving up for that one, because when it comes to those wrestling rings, I have bought me a Mattel. Oh, we're already damaging packaging. But the thing about this packaging, I don't even know why I'm being so careful with it. I didn't even save my Matt Hardy from AEW, which is the Damascus broken Matt Hardy. It's really hard to save these AEW packages. I try to follow, like, all the tape to make sure I don't damage it. So I feel like if I end up becoming a Kenny Omega fan, most likely I'm gonna take a picture with that guy. And I won't have to worry about damaging any packaging on that, because by that time I'll have a brand new Kenny Omega that I just might not open. So, taking into large consideration about this damaged packaging Kenny Omega, $20 well spent. I also didn't want a Kenny Omega that didn't have that, because I know he did that when he was the cleaner Kenny Omega. Like, I didn't even understand the gimmick. And that's like that one thing where, like, people complain about Cody Rhodes right now. They complain about Cody Rhodes right now, you know, about not understanding, like, his gimmick, not, you know, like, the fact that, oh, this guy literally just says a bunch of, like, big words that we just don't understand. It's like, why are you making it a big deal, and why are you giving Cody Rhodes such, like, a hard time? Like, the dude's back in WWE. He's doing very good. He's putting on great matches. Why are you giving the guy shit? But this isn't about Cody Rhodes right now. This is about a not damaged at all Kenny Omega. Like, yeah, for the most part, this is a really great wrestler. Aside from being well considered the best in the world, this is a pretty dope Kenny Omega. And I'm telling you, he had to have the interchangeable hands, because that's one of the things that I love about these new wrestlers, that they get different hands, they get multiple heads, and yeah. This is pretty cool. The more I get to know Kenny Omega, especially with you guys, like, I can only imagine where I'm going to be taken. Shout out Plug Pedro for putting me on. Like, I have a lot to learn, and I'm all ears, I'm all eyes on this. Like, I really want to get to know, like, the entire landscape of professional wrestling more than WWE, because as much as I love WWE is as much as, like, I can lose interest. And so far I haven't lost any interest, which I'm very happy about. It was kind of hard to take off this jacket, but otherwise it's fine. Just gotta make sure you take off, like, a hand. And yeah, this is pretty cool. It looks spray painted, or it's like digitally put on. As you can see, this is a lot of detail from that pay-per-view. It's pretty sweet. A lot of detail on the hand. The head scan. Super nice. Sorry if I'm just being all hands and stuff. Yeah, that's pretty cool. It's pretty sweet. Yeah. I can already tell I'm going to have fun with this one. I'm going to go ahead and give it a solid 10. Hey, Cheekies. You're going to get some random appearances from my dog as well. Dogs, because I have two dogs, two girls. And she just got a bath. You got a bath. Who got a bath? This is super cool. I know he has, like, a crazy, like, knee strike. Like, he has, like, some crazy knee strikes. And, like, definitely that's going to be a big deal for me. It's going to be a big deal for me, because I want to make sure that these guys can definitely do their moves and be very articulate. And that's the cool thing about the elbows as well. It's got extremely bendy elbows, which they always should have. I'm a minute over my time because wrestling just started, but I'm very glad that I was able to do a little unboxing, talk a little bit about my thoughts as to what some of these wrestlers are perceived as. Like I said, I'm a very big fan of Finn Balor. Can't wait to see him turn heel on AJ Styles. I'm calling it as is because I've been saying this for a while. Like, I really hope that AJ Styles, and Finn Balor, I hope they don't really become a tag team. Like, I'm pretty sure down the line it would be great, but for right now, I feel like they don't have enough of the people to make that happen. I feel like Shinsuke Nakamura on Raw would make a lot more sense to go ahead and make it like a New Japan faction. But it's not going to happen, I don't think. And the way WWE stories do go, I really do hope that Finn Balor does turn heel and accepts the demon and just takes advantage of that. Because if you go back to NXT 2019, Finn Balor turned heel, and that was one of the best heel turns that I've ever seen in professional wrestling, and especially in WWE. And there's probably better ones, but that was definitely, like, in my top 10 for sure. So, out of this figure, this is a 10 out of 10. He's going to go ahead and crush Finn Balor. They might team up. Bullet Club, might have to get some Bullet Club shirts for my wrestlers. It's a pretty cool thing, in my opinion. Comment below. Let me know what you guys think of this Kenny Omega figure, if you have it. If you have any matches for me to watch. Definitely gonna learn more about Kenny Omega, especially from my friend Plug Pedro. Thank you for putting me on. Like I said, you are the plug. And I'm gonna learn a lot. I'm gonna definitely soak in all this knowledge about Kenny Omega, and not gonna let this toy go to waste. Just very inspired, very happy. And we're gonna see you guys next time, especially with a video of me watching more about the Bullet Club, learning more about Finn Balor that I don't know about aside from WWE. And yeah, this is Ricky Rhymes, everyone, and I'm happy to be back. Thank you all for tuning in, the one to the millions, and I'm